80s, there was a musician strike. And that slowed everything down, really, in the session world for a while. I went down and was on picket duty, picket lines, at Lime Grove, which was a recording studio. And I was there with two lovely lady harpists. And a taxi arrived. And a sorted number of gentlemen got out, which turned out to be the village people. One of these lovely lady harpists went over and said, "You're not going to play music, are you? Because you have to cross our picket lines." And this nice gentleman said, "No, ma'am, we don't play, but we sing." Anyway, they did cross our picket lines, so I guess they were going to sing to a backing track anyway for Top of the Pops. But a few years later, all the orchestras for the BBC were axed. So we lost the radio orchestra and big band, the provincial orchestras, and then we were all more or less in the freelance world. I think the main problem was that the BBC had a lot of contract musicians and they were on not very good salaries but had a lot of perks. But the freelance players came in on bigger money, and the advent of ITV, which were paying a lot more money than the BBC. So if you had a TV or a film for television, the rates on ITV were better than the BBC. But in the general economics of everything, the sessions started decreasing. The advent of electronics, people were able to do rhythm sections at home on their own equipment, so weren't going into recording studios and using live musicians. When I look in my diaries, it got less and less through the 80s. So I started to get more involved with the local scene and my own big band and percussion. I took on a lot more teaching, and I'm happy to say that my children were getting older and getting involved in the music scene as well. Two or three of my better pupils were very good professionals. A couple went into the military, and I had a very, very good player who was a problem at school, to percussion, Saturday morning music school, which I taught at in Reading, Nigel Chipway. And he went on to become Catherine Jenkins, percussion player in her orchestra. He did a few very good sessions, film sessions, which I worked for him, and he became head of the Percussive Art Society in America. And he brought over a very good percussion player called Bobby Christian. We did a workshop at the Barbican at the Guildhall School of Music with Evelyn Glennie. There were still some good tours. Shirley Bassey had a few, and other gigs as well as long tours. But Howard Keel had a tour every year of a month of dates. So I was surviving financially, but diversifying in my home life, in that I was getting more involved in the local scene, the Reading Concert Orchestra, and also my own big band was starting to do a few things. Yes, there was a very good music scene in the Reading and what we call the Thames Valley area. Maidenhead, Marlow, and the surrounding area all had jazz clubs, which I was guesting and playing with different groups. With my own family involvement, Dulcie was playing vibes with a local big band. Lisa, as a teenager, was playing with a local big band on saxophone, playing cello with a local youth orchestra. Suzanne, my older daughter, was involved in music and drama. And son Peter was leaving college and wrote a musical for his degree project. And the outcome of that was that we hired the theatre in Henley and we put the show on for a week there. My home, my house, was turned into an overnight stay, evening meals and party time. Lisa went on to form a jazz quartet, saxophone jazz quartet called the Jezebels. She was also involved with the National Youth Jazz Orchestra, and I think I'm right in saying she was the first girl to play lead alto in the saxes, and did some wonderful gigs with them and learnt her trade there. Suzanne went on to form a group, the Flatlets. They did a couple of televisions. They did a series for Southern Television. San Peter started using me as his percussion player on a couple of things that he did for drama in Pebble Mill. And one was a very good series called The Ritz. So with Colin Sell, a piano player, you may know his name, and another very good musician, friend of Peter's, called Stuart Hall, and I went and did the music for him. My big band started from a nucleus of the brass members of the Reading Concert Orchestra. I was able to bring in guest musicians and soloists, and when I was short of players, so that developed into quite a local scene. It was very exciting to stand in front of a very good big band. We also took the band at the invitation of San Peter to the Hackney Empire for a comedy night. I remember I wrote some play-ons and play-offs for some of the acts, one of which was Joe Brand, and I wrote a little link to play her on called If I Knew You Were Coming, I'd Have Baked a Cake. And she turned around and she said, what the fuck was that? I've never heard of that before. What was that? Again, I was invited, and it was a lovely evening with a small band to play with for Peter, and I think daughter Lisa was on it as well, which was Barry Cryer's birthday. So the younger generation were taking over. Bill Ashton was the director of the National Youth Jazz Orchestra. The Nigel 2 big band, which were the training band really for the Nigel 1, which were the proper players and the older ones. A director called Paul Eshelby, who happened to be a trumpet player with the BBC Radio Orchestra, wasn't always available on Saturday, so he asked me if I would direct the Nigel 2 band, which I did. I would say that if you got into Nigel and you could handle the music that they put in front of you and be on the coach and go to Hull and perform, then you learnt your trade and you could sight read, you could be a pro. And that's why some of them are still the nucleus of the best of our players today through their experience in Nigel and coming from all over the country. I was booked for the music, a film drama for BBC Television for the film of the Bluebell Girls called Miss Bluebell. A few weeks later, after the film session, the session for the music, I was phoned by the production office and invited, if I could do it, to be the conductor in vision of the orchestra, which they were filming at an Art Deco cinema down in the east side of London, to conduct an orchestra that wasn't there, the Pitt Orchestra. And I think the reason I got booked to do the actual filming was that I'd done the musical track, so I knew the music, and there was no orchestra there. I was conducting an empty pit. The choreographer on Bluebell was Anthony Van Last, and now we're talking many, many years later. Daughter Lisa is doing a West End show called Tina the Musical. The choreographer was Anthony Van Last. Ah. And I would like to think that he remembered me from Bluebell. I also played for a band called the Bond Street Brigade, which was a pop brass band of all session players, with about four percussion players playing standard, what we call repertoire brass band music, but with a pop rhythm section. Another band I played with was called Mr. Pip's Marching Up and Down Band, which was put together by a trumpet player called Ian Cameron, who I toured with many, many years ago before I joined Jerry Allen with Roy Fox. But we had to dress up. The lady flute player was a fairy. I was the devil in black horns and red tights and costume, a straight player called Gary Cattell, was a gnome sitting on a toadstool, which he often fell off more than sat on it, playing the gonga drums. I got phoned up by an agent from Slough who asked me if I could book a string quartet, but he didn't want any violins. So I said, but that is a string quartet. No, I want four of those that stand on the floor. So I said, you mean cellos? He said, if you say so, which I did. I booked four cellos. So I don't know what sort of music they had to play, but that was his string quartet. So another happy customer. The same agent booked my big band for a shopping centre in Slough. A couple of days before, he asked me, your band's playing for me on Saturday. How much room do they want for the marching up and down? I said, I think you've got the wrong band. I said, we don't do marching up and down. I said, I have a job to get them to stand up, let alone march around. And I think that was cancelled. An example I can give you of how the music has changed and the attitude. Always musicians have been treated like labourers. Use the back door. Don't make a noise when you leave and behave yourself. Things have changed now. They are much more respected. And I think that's because of the attitude of performing on the continent. And Germany and France, you're much more respected as a musician. And you're treated, or have been treated, I know this from the Shirley Bassey tours. I went to Holland very late. I'd been doing play school and I... The only time I think I've ever had a car from the television centre to London Airport, instruments were put in for me, and I think it was the Concertgebouw in Amsterdam. And I arrived, and the nice doorman said, oh, they've had the sound check and the rehearsal. I knew you were going to be late. Have you had something to eat? Would you like a lie down? We've left some sandwiches for you. I'd never had that happen before, ever.
You know the proper response to that, don't you? Who books that?
And I played Ronnie Scott's in Gerrard Street in 1949-50 with Ralph Sharon and a couple of other people, Vic Ash, Dave Shepherd, who had a Benny Goodman type group. It was very basic. In fact, it was before Ronnie had enough chairs there, and he had forms, and it was always a difficult down an iron staircase to get in. And I played Ronnie's last week with Art Thiemann with his sextet, which I had the pleasure of recording a track with and vibes on. Anyway, Ronnie's was completely different. There's a lovely band room behind the stage. There were drinks provided, and then a gentleman came in and said, what would you like to eat? We've got a musician's menu. How things have changed.
And so you did a gig last week at the age of 96 with Art Thiemann. He's a spring chicken, isn't he? How old is he?
Art is 80.
Yes.
And he asked me if I would do this track for him because he wanted a vibe player to cover, I think it was a Wes Montgomery tune. And I said, no, Art, I don't do that anymore. I don't do recording. But I would like you to do this because I just want the vibe sound with the ensemble. So I said, OK, I'll record it for you. I'll track it on and you needn't use it if you don't like it. But it's turned out very well. The record's not out yet, the album. It's available online, but it's called Art Thiemann and Friends. And he's used some wonderful players. And I had the privilege and the enjoyment of playing alongside Art on the one track on his album.
Lovely.
I was very fortunate to have that. First of all, was being rung up by Ralph Sharon when I was virtually unknown, scrabbling around Soho, and I was with him 2 years when he went to America. I was lucky to be asked to join Jerry Allen and his trio, which was the start of my variety career, which I had no idea I was going into, having been a jazz vibes player. And then, when Lunchbox finished, back to being a musician. Fortunately, I'd started to play percussion, so I was able to diversify, and then to get into teaching and be able to pass some of that experience on to young players. So my life has gone in stages, and it's always been for the best. Even now, and when I was discovered by Pete Long, at the age of 80, my late 80s, when he happened to speak to Lisa, daughter Lisa, on a session that he was looking for a vibes player to, because he was putting a band together called Gillespiana, and did anybody know a vibes player? And Lisa said, my dad plays the vibes. So I was rediscovered as a jazz player again in my late 80s, playing Ronnie Scott's again after a lifetime of doing variety and teaching and everything else. There are many places that I've played all over the world, and I think Britain is best.
Well, we'll put the Land of Hope and Glory underneath.
Yes. Maybe the flag.
Anything else you want to say? We'll call it naughty stories that will black out names.
Yeah, like Shirley Bassey lying on the floor at rehearsal and the
trouble. Still running. Oh.
So I'll tell you a name, and you can save it.
Yeah, okay.